Are you ready? Stand by.
Welcome to the 3-Gun Show, episode 29. I am your host, Dave Hartman, and today we are joined by the one and only Jerry Michalek. Before we get into the interview, I want to thank you for downloading and listening to the show. The 3-Gun Show is a weekly podcast dedicated to the fastest growing shooting sport, 3-Gun. Each week you get a new episode delivered directly to your iDevice or your Android, featuring the most interesting personalities in the sport. And we have a little chat. We talk about gear, shooting, stage breakdown, traveling to a match, and whatever else comes to mind. And it's all for free. It's amazing. Another cool thing we've been doing over on the show is running a couple giveaways. And we have another great one this week featuring gear from LAG Tactical. Be sure to listen at the end of the show for your chance to enter and win. All right, on to the show. In this week's interview, I headed out on the road and found myself in Raton, New Mexico at the NRA Whittington Center for the 2015 Rocky Mountain 3-Gun match. And I caught up with the legendary Jerry Michalek after the second day of shooting, and Jerry really gave a great interview, and you are absolutely going to love it. Links to everything that we cover in the interview can be found in the show notes, so if you're listening to this on your way to the range or heading home from a match or something like that, be sure to head over to 3gunshow.com/episode29 when you get in front of a computer. And now, please join me in welcoming the show, five-time NRA world record holder and revolver, five-time USPSA 3-Gun national champ, and just generally an awesome guy, Jerry Michalek. All right, so we're here at Rocky Mountain 3-Gun, and I've tracked down the man, the myth, the legend, Jerry Michalek. Got to see him shoot his stage today, and it was quite fast, which, as usual, and managed to bring Jerry back to his own abode here in the competition headquarters, or the shooter's accommodations at the Whittington Center here at NRA. And Jerry, I want to thank you for joining me on the 3-Gun Show.
My pleasure, Dave. Good to be here.
All right. Well, this should be a good time. We're sitting in the middle of a kitchen, and hopefully no one needs to cook anything while we're doing this. But we got a barbecue coming up here, so that should be on everyone's mind. So Jerry, curious, want to take it like all the way back. I got like 1,000 questions for you, but basically want to give us an idea of like who you are when you're not shooting, who you are off the range. What do you do in your spare time?
Well, I'm a tinkerer. I got to always be doing something. So we have a 150-acre range back home, so that keeps me pretty busy. I'm the guy that cuts the grass, takes out the trash, works on the equipment. So I maintain all my own equipment, and I come from a mechanic background. I was a millwright for 16 years, so certified welder and MIG, TIG, and do all that stuff. So I was a multi-craft mechanic, so I just enjoy doing things. If you don't see me on the range, I'm working on guns, working on equipment, tuning up a lawnmower, or just I'm a hands-on kind of guy, you know. Just got to be doing something.
Nice. It's like the mechanical part of it.
I hear that
from a lot of guys.
I like the aspect of that, yep.
So were you like into cars growing up and things?
Oh yeah,
like that?
We built. I had a Ford Bronco. I built it top. You know, back in 1974, I had. Matter of fact, I bought an old Bronco. I had to cut it in half and buy another half and weld it together and put it on a chassis and built all the differentials and stuff, transmission, and used to go run the mud with it and have fun.
Wow, yeah, you built that one the hard way.
It was. I welded it together with coat hangers. I took it. My mom liked to run me out the house. I used up all the coat hangers welding that thing together, but it came out all right.
That's awesome. So was that like stick welding? I didn't know you could weld with coat hangers.
Well, you just use acetylene.
Acetylene weld.
Yeah. So.
And that held together?
Oh, yeah. Came out beautiful.
Nice.
Yeah, you can do a lot of stuff with the coat hanger. Built a few airboats with coat hangers and conduit, so.
Wow.
Works out pretty good.
Sweet. So if my truck breaks down on the way home,
we got some baling wire and we can get it going. So,
well, that's awesome. So whenabouts did it take a turn to shooting for you then?
Well, I was always interested in hunting, and being from South Louisiana, we were fortunate to have a lot of good hunting in the area. The bad thing about it, when hunting season was over, you put the gun in the closet. So the idea was to try to shoot all year. So we got introduced into competition shooting. I met an old boy from Arizona by the name of Ben Ashmore in 1976. He was a contractor working some of the chemical plants along the river there where I grew up in South Louisiana. And he had a Swenson 45, which have you ever heard of Swenson?
I never have, no.
He was one of the top pistol smiths back in the day.
Okay.
And he was working out of a leather holster. He had magazines. He was doing mag changes and stuff. And back then, they called it combat shooting.
Right.
So when I saw him, he was at a local dump, which where everybody shot. You know, when we was kids, you go to the dump, shoot stuff. He was there, and he had some steel targets on a stick, and he was drawing out of a holster shooting these targets with a Swenson 45. And it was just like, man, this is pretty trick.
Yeah.
Really nice guy. And he was in the area for a couple of months doing some electrical contract work and got to know him real good. And he was doing some little competitions at the sheriff department. So it was 1976 when I first shot my first competition. So it was kind of fun.
Well, that's cool. So what did they call the competitions back then? Was that USPSA?
No, this is before USPSA.
Okay. So it was just like a unorganized type
they
thing?
They just called it a little combat match.
Oh, that's
pretty
cool.
They called it combat match. You had stopwatches.
Yeah.
And you had two pieces of aluminum you hit together, and you started the clocks, and you had always had a stop target. You had two guys running a stopwatch, and they would stop them, and you compare the times and average it and write it down. So we didn't have timers. That was before they had electronic timers.
Right.
So it was kind of early on in the game, and before USPSA was actually established, 76.
So how long did you shoot those matches then?
We shot those for a couple of years, and then we started doing our own. Mm-hmm. Ben went on his way doing his contract work, and we started doing matches ourselves in Thibodaux, Louisiana, about 1980. I think we started our first one. We had the Canebrake Combat Shooters was our club, and we shot those matches up until about 85. And then there were more handgun matches starting, USPSA and a Second Chance bowling pins. You ever heard of Second Chance?
I have.
We started my first Second Chance match was 1982, and I shot them all the way up until the last year. I think it was 98 or 99. So I shot about 20 years up there. And what was really nice about Second Chance, you can win guns. So our first year up there, we went up by Amtrak train. It was kind of this will tell you how it went. I had a backpack, an old GI backpack that weighed about 90 pounds. It was full of guns. I had two ammo cans in each hand, put brown paper around them, get on a train. Got off in Kalamazoo, Michigan. We went shooting, my buddy and I. And, hell, I think I won six guns that year.
Six guns, wow.
We had a Python and a couple of 29s, a couple of H&K 91s. We stuck it all in backpacks and got back on the train.
Got back on the train?
And came back home, you know. So
that's
it was kind
awesome.
Of fun. And we realized you could actually do some fun stuff and win guns. So we started hitting Second Chance pretty hard.
That's cool. So now in those early days, did you practice a lot, or do you feel like you had like some natural ability?
Well, it was just the opposite. I had no ability.
Oh, okay.
So the interest was to always get better. So I put a lot of hours into it.
Yeah, and what kind of practice did you do?
A lot of revolver shooting. The revolver aspect of the game was what really had my motivation. And tried to be the fastest revolver shooter in the world. That's what I wanted to do, you know. So I pursued that and went on. And when I hired on with Smith & Wesson, I actually established that fact.
Right.
So I have five NRA-sanctioned world record shooting revolvers. So, and they're all NRA-certified, which is really different than most guys who say they have a record.
Right.
So the NRA actually has a person that you can hire out, and he'll come out and certify your attempt.
No kidding.
Yeah, he comes out and looks at the watches and what you're doing, and he write it off. And so these are actually all certified NRA-sanctioned world records.
So what does that world record entail? Like is it like a competition or is it just?
No, this was just speed shooting. One of them was how many, five rounds on target in 57 one-hundredths of a second. And then eight shots in 1 second with a revolver. And then I did a speed load drill, shoot six and reload in 2.99 one-hundredths.
Jeez.
Then we did five guns. It was 10 revolvers in a row on a table. First one in your hand, when you shot your last shot, I had a 17.12 seconds. So I put 60 rounds on target in 17 seconds.
Oh, my God.
So I averaged 27 hundredths of a second for 10 guns.
That's incredible.
So it was kind of fun. That was something I've been wanting to do for a long time.
Well, that's pretty sweet. So you set your eyes on becoming the best revolver shooter
out
there, and now you've got like the paper that says that you
Yeah,
you
it
are.
Was fun. It was a good race. So won a bunch of nationals and the Steel Challenge, and just so I kind of got into the three gun real heavy.
Uh-huh.
So I hadn't really shot much revolver since then, the last couple of years. But the three gun, we started off with Soldier of Fortune in the 80s. I think my first Soldier of Fortune three gun was 85.
Okay.
Oh, maybe a little bit earlier. There was the only three gun match in the United States.
Oh, okay.
It paid 10 grand for the winner.
That's pretty good, even on today's standards.
Like, you know,
in 1985, 10 grand was a lot of money.
It is. So in a shooting game, that was big money. I didn't do much good at the few first couple of them. I did manage to come in second place with a revolver one year, and I was out of first place like 1/13 of a second.
Oh, wow.
So I almost won Soldier of Fortune with a revolver. That many folks can say that. So
that would have been incredible.
But I actually won the SOF competition three times. But I had to go to a pistol to do it. But so that three gun kind of started. Then USPSA started doing three gun matches.
Mm-hmm. So for those first Soldier Fortune matches, you mentioned that you shot a revolver.
Yep.
And then you switched to a pistol. What did your gear setup kind of look like then? Give us an idea of
the pistols.
With. Yeah, pistol, the rifle, and the shotgun.
Okay, back in the early days, yeah, you could only use like a stock configuration on the rifle.
Okay.
So the only optic that was legal is if you shot a Steyr AUG.
Oh,
which had
okay.
the optics built into the handle.
Yeah.
That was kind of a trick setup. So I shot a gold cup, just pretty much out of the box with metallic sights. And the shotgun, I had some Remington 1100s, I think, back then. And the pistol was a STI, high-capacity pistol, 40 caliber. So you had to have major then. And it kind of progressed from there.
And it got more and more gamer-like?
Yeah, you had to game it. You know, the evolution of the sport, you know, things change, guns change, technique change.
Yeah.
So.
Well, it's like anything, you put men in women in competition.
Right.
And they'll find, you know, the next little bit that's going to get them that
edge. Next gizmo.
That's right. Next gizmo, the next technique and stuff like that.
Yep.
So you mentioned the last few years you've been getting into it real heavy.
Yep.
And so what made that swing into like, well, I'm going to commit all my time to three gun now?
Well, you know, a professional shooter, if you shoot really hard and a lot, Smith & Wesson hired me out professionally in 1990. So I've got like 25 years behind a double action trigger. So I probably shot 1.5 million rounds or so, 2 million rounds.
Wow.
So it gets to a point to where you're going to start tearing your hands up. So I figured I'd throttle back on the handguns and start shooting other firearms to prolong my competitive line.
Okay.
You know, so that's one of those you could really, to stay that hot on a revolver for all those years is a lot of work. It's a lot of fire, you know, 60,000, 80,000 rounds a year. And it gets hard on your hands. So I'm just trying to throttle back on that. I'm still shooting a lot of pistol, but nowhere near the level. So I'm taking in the shotgun more and the rifle, of course, to help ease the burden on the hands.
Mm-hmm.
So
you shoot open. Is that
yes.
Right?
Yep.
What drew you to open? What made you decide that's going to be the division I shoot in?
The vision part.
Okay.
When you get to be 60 years old, that's what happens when you shoot a metallic handgun, a metallic sighted handgun. You have to have a correction to see the sight, and then a correction on your left eye. I'm right eye dominant, so that correction is for the front sight, mm-hmm. and the left eye is for the target.
Okay.
So what happens is if you close your left eye, the target will blur completely out.
Right.
So when you go from it makes everything harder when you get the clarity of the target, just the transition times as your eyes age get slower, and then you don't see the target as sharp. So it really gets to be a burden on the shooter. So you have to find ways to stay competitive in the game. So the optics part really helps an old guy like me stay competitive.
Yeah.
So that's what I have to do, you know, to stay competitive.
So I've heard that from, you know, quite a few shooters that shoot in open, and I have to say that, like, when I look at, like, open shooters at the matches I go to, generally there's a demographic, right?
Yeah, it is, yep.
Do you ever consider, like, if, you know, someone, like, 19, 20 years old, shooting open, their entire career comes in, you know, at age 30, they're just going to smoke it? I mean,
yeah,
it doesn't
it's destined,
like,
you know. It's they just have the lung capacity and everything else to go with it, you know.
Right.
So I'm just trying to hang on as long as I can. If you look at the bullseye game, back when my father-in-law, Jim Clark, was shooting bullseye, when you got in your 50s, that was about it. You just couldn't see good enough.
Right.
No matter what you did with your corrections, you just – and the optics in the bullseye games have really extended the life of a bullseye competitor, you know, because these guys had to shoot like 26, 80s, you know, to stay competitive. And with the optics, you can do that nowadays, even though you're 50, 60 years old. So it really helped in that game. It's helping in my game for me to be here. Really, I shouldn't be here shooting against these guys. These guys can pick me up and run with me faster than I can run, you know. So I'm just here to have fun and just aggravate them as much as I can. So,
well, it's great, though, because you say that, but every time I hear one of these guys talk, you know, they're like, well, you know, then there's Jerry you got to think about. So it's good that you're putting the fear of God into the youngins still, you know.
And I want to insult them a little bit, the old man run them over, you know. It's fun. It keeps you active.
Yeah. You ever poke them at the end like, hey, I got 30 years on you. I got 40 years on you.
I'll let them worry about that.
Well, that's awesome. So let's talk about your gear setup a little bit. You know, I can tell by, you know, sitting here staring at you that you've got a lot of good sponsors that are helping you out. You mentioned Smith & Wesson.
Yep.
And I saw you shooting an M&P.
Yep.
And so let's start off with that pistol. What's the setup like on it?
Okay, it's an M&P core, which means it's a 5-inch. It's a long slide.
Mm-hmm.
This one's magnaported. It's been quadruported by Magnaport. And I've got an optic on the slide. Of course, the old man, you know, gig there, you know, got to have see what you're missing. It's got a magwell and a tungsten guide rod, just about everything you could do with it. I just take the factory trigger parts and modify them and run it that way. So it's probably got a little bit under 3-pound trigger. Got a extension on the magazine, so they hold 26 rounds, so the 170-millimeter magazine. I do have to say, though, that M&P magazine is probably the most trouble-free magazine I've ever run in my life.
Oh, really?
Yeah, on any kind of double stack. I've had the same springs in there for about 6 years.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, just like just put it in a sonic cleaner maybe once in a while, maybe.
Maybe.
Maybe. Same follower, same everything, just shoot it. So the gun really functions good. A slide-mounted optic, I would rather have a frame-mounted optic, maybe a little bit bigger, but that's not going to happen. So I just have to live with what I have. And the rifle is a Smith & Wesson Performance Center. Of course, one thing about an AR, you can tweak it a zillion different ways.
Yeah, and then so.
Of course, it has my compensator on it, and it has a Vortex 1x6 scope on it, and I have a Vortex red dot on the side. You know, you can shoot two optics in open, so that works really good. Has an American Gold trigger in it. The other little pieces and parts, you know, make it what it is. It's an extremely accurate gun. That's one of my best ones I've ever had right there. So it's my match gun. I only shoot it when I need to shoot it. It's when you need long-range accuracy, so I kind of baby that one. And the shotgun is a Mossberg. It's a JM 930. It's a gas gun. They've sponsored me with Mossberg now for about 4 or 5 years. And that's one of my original guns that I had gotten from them. So it's got a lot of hours on it. I turned it into an open gun.
Yeah,
so it's got a 16-round extension on it, and a load and shoot for the speed loaders, and an optic on the top, and it's magnaported. Magnaport was kind enough to work with me on a porting that I like,
mm-hmm.
and they tailored it to exactly the way I wanted it. So it shoots about as fast as I can make it happen. So one thing about the Mossberg guns, they're really fast. You can get down 1,200 splits with them if you can stand up on it, you know.
Wow.
So it'll sing a song if you're mad enough to hump it, it'll sing, you know.
That's awesome. Now, so the Mossberg, when those first came out, like the JM 930s,
yeah.
I remember seeing like pictures of you with yours, you know, huge extension on it, and you had like this compensator. It looked like it belonged like on a Barrett.
Yes.
Is that what we're talking about still, or have you changed that setup?
That barrel was one that they had marketed it for, I don't know exactly what market it was, but it was a Barrett-style aluminum brake on the front. It didn't have a choke in it. Mm. I actually shot those in competitions for a couple of years. I liked the way it shot. It shot really good. The only disadvantage of it, the choke was way inside of that compensator, and you had to use an extension to get to it. So I kind of weaned myself off of that, and it was just too hard to change chokes fast.
Yeah.
So I just went with a regular conventional barrel and had it magnaported, and it works just as good. So, but there is something to say about a compensator closer to the bore. I mean, closer to the chamber, you get more gas in it.
Right.
So it worked really good. I just didn't like the idea of messing with the chokes. I had, you know, I had it just.
Well, for this game too, when we're changing chokes so often.
Yep.
You know, based on like the stages that we're going to.
Yep.
Yeah, I totally hear you. It makes more sense on that. So then how about your belt setup? I saw you you know, running around with like some, looks like a Indian arrows type thing.
Yeah, Safarlane makes that loading apparatus, I guess you'd have to call it, for the speed sticks, and they hold five tubes. Some matches you have to put two of them on, where you need 10 tubes. There's going to be a stage here where I'll have 10 of them on me, and probably some ammo in my pocket.
Wow.
I think it's a 40-round stage here. So the gun will hold 17. And the idea, you got to try to keep it hot, keep a lot of ammo in it. When these aerial targets come out, you know, they're 10 points apiece, plus a failure to engage penalty. So you always got to have bullets in the thing to make it happen. So a lot of ammo on your person is a good thing.
Yeah, no kidding. Well, especially on a 40-round stage.
Yep.
So it seems like, you know, there's always like someone out trying to, or, you know, match records trying to outdo each other, getting more and more shotgun rounds on a stage.
Yep.
Where do you think that sweet spot is?
I would say in the 30s is way enough. What happens is it's so much space on your body. I think about my daughter when she shoots. She's kind of a small person. She doesn't have a big waist.
Mm-hmm.
So you're kind of a disadvantage of how much ammo you can hang on your person. You get a big guy, you know, he's got a 47-inch waist. You can put two or three boxes of shells up there, you know. So there's a point of no return on everything. Unfortunately, a lot of the shotgun matches, well, it is now, it's turned into a...
Whoa.
Hey, it's getting close.
It's
I'm glad I'm
about to
inside.
Rain out there.
I'm glad it's... I'm glad I'm inside.
Yeah, no
but
kidding.
On the shotgun matches now, it's really to the point to where speed loading is everything. So, and it's so much loading going on, it takes a lot of practice to stay current with that. And it's evolving too. It used to be everybody was loading single, and they started loading doubles. Now there's quad loading. And I'm waiting for somebody to come up with six of them at a time, but I hadn't seen it yet. But
my hands are not big enough for that. I mean, I fumble the quad loads all the time.
So it's pretty interesting how things evolve, and it's really quick.
Yeah, for sure.
So
it's, you know, I watched a lot of shotgun stages and a lot of good people loading today, and it was, you know, it is pretty incredible. But, you know, you're right when you talk about, like, the smaller shooters.
Right.
Especially the ladies. Like, you watch them doing, like, two rows. So they've got, like, a chest rig. Yep. And then belt set up, and just absolutely everything is covered for that.
They run out of real estate real quick.
Yeah, for
so
sure.
It's harder on the smaller people.
So have you tried the quad load at all?
Yeah, I have. I hate it.
Yeah. You want the sticks?
Well, I'm not as good with it. I have to load with my weak hand.
Okay.
My hand's a little large to do it with strong hand. That's another thing. The bigger your hands are, the harder it is to get around the ammo in these holders. And the wider your hand, it's just...
For like getting your finger between the
shell
and the holder.
The smaller hands fit the loaders better. And my daughter shoots, she quad load like she's on fire. And her hand is just the right size. Well, my little finger's as big as a thumb.
Right.
You know, so that's the differences, you know, between the size of the hands. So when she grabs out of those pouches, she's got a lot of room. When I grab, I can't hardly get my hands in between the shells. And then when I want to handle them quick, it's just all that hand gets in the way.
So you don't shoot shotgun with Lena because she's smoky on it?
Yeah, she will smoke me really bad. So really bad. Yeah, she had a pull up. She shot the last championship there, the one at Rock House, and came in third overall.
Really?
Yeah.
That's fantastic.
Overall. So there's no way I'm going to get on the line next to her. So I'll stick in my open division, go hide somewhere in a corner.
Nice. Let her have her day, and you'll do the open.
Yeah, they're getting ready to go to the World Championships in Italy. So they're working at it really hard. So
she's got a title to defend, right?
Yep. That was her first world title last, 2 years ago now. So she's pretty stoked up and ready to fly. So
yeah, well, the look on your face looks like you're stoked up too about it.
Yeah, she does good. You know what's amazing was when she started really shooting competitive, I could tell her things. And she could pick it up and see exactly the way I see. And I've trained a bunch of folks through the years, and she's the only one I could tell something like that visual. And this game is such a visual performance. A lot of people think it's very physical or it's very technical. It's not. It's a vision game. That those who see the fastest are going to always execute the fastest. And I can explain a vision technique that might have taken me 15 years to see and duplicate on command. Like when I do a Smith & Wesson demo or a performance in front of a crowd,
mm-hmm.
if you don't have your visual clues in order before you attempt that stunt, it's not going to happen. And I could tell her, and she could pick it up in just a few minutes. And it was stunning to me that she could pick that up.
So give me an example of like those type of visual cues that you're talking about.
Soft focus. A lot of people don't know how to soft focus on targets, and the gun gets in the way. That's a very basic problem. They're looking at the target so hard, next thing you know, that gun gets in the way. Well, where did this thing come from? Well, you should have seen it way before it got under your dominant eye. You know, seeing more than one target at a time. Being able to see more than maybe three targets at a time. Interact, you know, your field of view is always what I'm working on when I'm trying to shoot. And when I do my drills, I want to have a huge field of view, because the more you see, the more you can interact with. Knowing where to look and how much to look. You can stare something to death and you don't really need it. If you got a target 5 feet away, it doesn't take much skill to get that front sight in the middle of this brown piece of paper and put two shots in it.
Right.
You know, so knowing how to look soft and keep the gun in focus, maybe it was not the full extension or the vision skills. It's just hard to explain, but it's everything in this game. If you watch the guys who really shoot fast, they know how to see fast.
Do you have any sort of like drills or practice that you do for your vision to keep you in good shape?
I'm always working, and the older my eyes get, the harder it is. They don't focus as fast as what they used to, so I have to really be keen on understanding what I need to see before I pull that gun out of the holster. Mm-hmm. And how I'm going to see in between targets. Like if you got a target 6 foot apart, am I going to ride the red dot into the target, or I'm going to leave the gun, find the target, then bring the gun back in, and where I'm going to pick the dot back up coming into the target? Little things like that.
Mm-hmm.
If you have a 12 target scenario, you save 10th of a second times 12 is 1.2 seconds. You know, so it's all the little stuff always adds up. So if you look at the guy shooting very, very, what we might want to say is fast, but it's very smooth.
Right.
And it looks like they're not doing anything special, but because they're not wasting any time. All they are trying to do is use that time that's just going to benefit them. So take all the trash out and just shoot it steady.
So how do you then decide if you're going to be riding that dot between targets or if you're going to be looking to the next target?
But it also has to do with the level of the shooter.
Uh-huh.
You know, you just can't tell somebody to do this. If I went into a secretary's office and she's typing and she's looking at me and she's doing 60 words, you know, a second or something, or in a minute, you know, and she's looking at me and she's still typing. It took her 10 years of experience on those keys to get to that. So she could tell me, yeah, look at me in the eye and type. It's going to take me 10 years to see that.
Ah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So you can express it verbally, but you have to put the hours in to actually see it. But what you have to also do is learn how to catalog an event and put a value to it. So if you had a good visual moment on the range, you ought to be able to feed off of it and be able to come back to it. As a professional, you have to be able to have vision tier skills that you can come in and out of.
So then when one of those events like you were talking about happens on the range,
right,
then you have to be cognizant of it, hold on to that moment,
yep,
and then catalog it for future use?
Yep, definitely. Yeah, it's hard. It's a lot of guys that have a stunning run, and they'll turn around and say, man, I burned it, and then they can't repeat it.
Yeah.
You know, that moment's gone, and the reason is they didn't understand what they were seeing. So when you get enough hours in, you actually start to understand what visual clues are important and when you need to apply them. And that's just hours and hours of repetition, but it's also being able to look for these clues as you progress through your training. I call it having a moment.
Right.
You have a moment on the range. Sometimes I even stop and go home. I'm shooting on a range. I have a beautiful visual moment. I'll just go back to the house. That's it for the day. Just feed off of it and come back and try to pick it up again cold. There's cold runs and there are hot runs. If I've shot 100 rounds, well, I'm going to be pretty good. You're not going to have that advantage when you get on the line and they say, let's go.
Yeah.
So to understand the difference on that means a lot to the shooter on his cold performances.
Yeah, so that is one thing that I struggle with in my own three-gun shooting, mm-hmm, as well, is getting out there and performing right off the bat.
Yep.
When in my practice, when I'm running drills, you know, my third or fourth run, I'll start to get a swing or something like that. So how do you train yourself to perform right out of the box?
There again, understanding what you need to see. If you can try to make it happen or you can watch it happen. If you try to make it happen, you're never going to be good. If you watch it happen, it's always going to be good. Trying to make anything happen takes you off of your state of where you are at the moment. Once you've hung an expectation on a performance, you're dead. You're absolute dead. Like, you know, you turn around, hey, guys, watch me burn this down. Not usually.
Yeah, famous
because,
last words.
Because your expectation won't allow you to take the time it takes to execute that shot. Because subconsciously, you're never going to shoot fast enough. But if you always shoot as fast as you can see, you're on your mark all the time. Because if you go back through your performances and you try to grade it, you can always come back to, you know, I didn't really call that shot. I never really stopped the gun. Never had a visual moment. I shot a blur. I came at the target. The gun never stopped. I never saw a front sight. I shot at a blur. I never saw the edges of the target. So you never saw anything. Then you can't repeat what you can't see. So one thing feeds off of the other, feeds off of the other. And once you stack a bunch of negatives in there, it's always trying to expect something is a big boat anchor. That's what I call running with the ball or running after the ball.
Right.
You know, once you have a few wins under your belt, you got that, hey, man, I'm the man. You know, I'm going to shoot this really fast. The anchor even gets bigger. So it takes more talent to overcome that anchor. Because once you hang an expectation on your performance, it was like I was to put a 2x12 on the floor, 10 foot long.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody and their brother could walk it. I put it up 10 feet.
Oh, yeah.
You put it up 100 feet.
That's
it. And you put it up 1,000 feet. And the only thing different is that expectation of a performance. Now I put a skill level on it. I have to walk this thing. And you get real choppy. And your muscles are real jittery. It's the same thing when you shoot a match. You put an expectation of a performance because it has a value now. And once you assign a value to it, you're going to second guess every motion you make. And you get real choppy. And you counteract everything you see in with that expectation, I got to do this better. Instead of just walking a 2x4, can't do it. You lock up. Same thing in a match.
Wow.
Make sense?
Yeah, it totally does. I mean, that's like the best way to put it because that's like a context everyone can understand. Yeah.
I can walk that plank. You put it up on it. You put it up and give it a value, and now you got your life on it. Pretty high value, isn't it?
Absolutely.
But a lot of people put that much value on a competition. Instead of just relaxing and just seeing it and making it happen, they want to make it happen. Then you get that real choppy feeling. That's that expectation of a performance overriding your natural moment.
Mm-hmm.
And then you lose it. Easy to say, hard to do.
Yeah, it
most
totally
things
is.
In life are so easy, but they're so hard to do. The guys who can mount a gun and it's shaking all over the place and they can still trigger a shot are those that's going to always do well.
Yeah, and then there's that whole thing of, you know, the whole guys watch this type thing.
Oh, yeah.
So you get out there and it's like, I'm going to burn this stage
down.
What
happened? A testosterone clouds your vision.
Yeah.
You know?
Oh, God, it does.
It's hard if that testosterone will make you very erratic.
Yeah.
Big guy syndrome.
Been responsible for, you know, a bunch of bad decisions and most guys
it's
will,
sunk
for
many,
a long time.
It's sunk many a battleship.
That's true.
So
Jerry, what is, these days, you've got this proficiency level. You've been shooting since 1976, right? Is that what you said?
Yep.
So what does your practice look like on like a day-to-day, week-to-week, or month-to-month basis? And specifically, how do you get ready for a match like this at Rocky Mountain 3-Gun?
This one is such an equipment-oriented event. You got to have perfect equipment. If you have any doubts, I'd rather have stuff that really didn't shoot all that well, but it went bang every time I pulled the trigger. If you don't have confidence in what you have in your hands, it's never going to be good. So equipment has to be good. You want to have everything and access to what you need when you need it. Get up on the line, have all your stuff, have a checklist. You'd be surprised how many people don't have all their equipment on their belt when they get called to the line.
We saw it today.
Yeah.
Right?
It's happened many
times. Mr. Yackley had to run back for his magazine.
You have these small things. Like before I shoot, I'll do a dot check on all my guns. I'll physically touch everything on my belt. I'll look at the stage and I'll just go back through it mentally and try to walk it with my eyes closed so I know where every target is. So should I get a malfunction with one of the firearms, that when you look down and clear this malfunction, when you come up, you should know where you are. You don't want to be like that goose that I wake up in a different world every morning. You don't want to have that event. So you should be able to see every target. First thing I do on a stage, I walk it and I see every target. Got to find every shot you're going to make. Then after you walk it a few times, you should be able to go back, turn around, close your eyes, and know where every target is. And you should know where the distances are on the rifle shots. If you don't, you're leaving a whole lot of meat on the bone And that's an expectation of a performance, and it's not going to be a performance. So you can't have anything. I always have extra ammunition. I always have an extra magazine. I have an extra few speed loaders. So if you get into trouble, you need to drop a magazine, you only have another one. You don't want to be picking it off the ground.
Yeah.
Because once you break vision off the event, you're going to be like that goose. You're going to wake up in a new world, and then you're going to skip a target. You're going to run by a target. So last thing you want to do is dig the grave deeper than you can jump out of. You ever heard that saying?
I haven't, but I like that.
What it is, if you find yourself in a stage, you have a malfunction, you see a lot of guys kick the speed back up.
Right.
You already dug a grave, okay? You're that much in a hole, and they take off, and they miss a bunch more targets, and the grave is so deep, nowhere in the match can you jump out of it. You've got a hole you can't climb out of. So you have to expect that when you screw it up, keep it small. Even if it's big, there's nothing you can do about it. It's just happening. So just live with it. Live with the moment. Keep grunting through it. Finish it up strong. Just don't make it such a catastrophic failure that you can never overcome it in a match. So you're going to drag that anchor through the whole match, but you never know. The other guy might be dragging one too. You just hadn't seen his hole, how deep it is. So you just got to keep plugging along. Keep yourself honest. You don't have to win every stage. Just have to stay constant.
I like that. So, yep. Jerry, got just a couple minutes yep. here, and then we need to break as I yep. hear some stomachs rumbling.
Yep.
But just tell me real quick about the best stage that you've had so far out of 2 days of shooting.
Well, probably the best one I had was this last one off the rooftop there. Yesterday, I wasn't really feeling good. I think it was the altitude and what I was eating here. I had my stomach was just on fire. And this morning, I felt a little better. I wish I had some salt tablets up here. Got a little bit. I wasn't dehydrated, but I don't think I was on a good level. Anyway, felt a little bit better after lunch. Started shooting good. The last stage was pretty solid. So I would say that was probably my best one yet. So I'm hoping tomorrow I'll smooth out a little bit more. So they're starting to pick up speed. I was real choppy on the first and just had no air in me at all. It was like I was in slow motion.
And so you're getting acclimated. So yeah, what?
Somewhat, yeah.
How was that stage? I know that you had to shoot from a rooftop, and yeah. there were some distance targets, but can right. you describe it briefly for us?
Well, you started off with the shotgun. You had a slug target at about 80 yards. Then you transitioned into three steel targets. Then you ran up and shot a steel on the left and a steel on the right, and ran up and shot three more steel targets on the right. Reloaded a stick of slugs, shot another bird shot. On a birdshot target, of course, shot a slug target at about 60 yards, transitioned over to two more slug targets at about 80 and 95 yards, shot those two, transitioned back to three more birdshot targets, finished up there, put the gun on safe, threw in the drum, unstrapped your rifle off your back, loaded a mag, shot two paper targets, got on the rooftop, which was backwards. It was a backwards rooftop.
Right.
Kind of did a rollover prone. Shot a target at 230, 285, 255, 180, and 140. Shot three more paper on the run to a spool. Shot another paper. Took the bipod out. Shot a target at 130, 180, 200, 255, and 380, I think.
Wow. It's quite the stage.
Yeah. It was. So I remember it.
Yeah, absolutely. So
that's how you have to. That's how much you have to put into it. If you don't. They give you, what's really a luxury here is that you have a lot of time. You could come before the match and actually mm-hmm. walk the stages. If this was a world IPSC match, as a squad, you get 3 minutes. Can't take any notes.
Wow.
Can't write on your hand. Can't take any notes. And that's it, 3 minutes. So if you got 10 guys on a squad and you got 3 minutes to look at each, you know, the whole stage, you don't have but a few seconds at each position. So the setups are so important. So this is like a luxury here. So I can write this stuff on my hands. I had notes all over. I still have them here. So
that one says eggs and milk, though.
Yeah. But anyway, it's just fun. You always shoot against yourself. You know, if you shoot against yourself, you always have a good match. You can't control the other guy anyway.
That's great.
You know.
So Jerry, one final question yep. for you: if you can leave the audience with just one thought or one piece of advice, what would it be?
Have fun.
Can't say it any better than that, right?
I've been doing this for since 76, so it still lights me up. I still enjoy doing it, you know. It gets me out of bed in the morning.
Well, and you can definitely tell, like, you know, everyone out there has probably seen one of your YouTube videos, and at the end, you know, you're laughing, you're having a good time, and it definitely shows through.
Beats working for a living. I did that for a while, and I didn't like it.
Well, sweet. That's another good piece of advice. Well, Jerry, you know, thank you for your time, and, you know, thanks for joining me on the 3-Gun Show.
My pleasure. Enjoyed it. Thank you.
I hope you enjoyed that interview with Jerry Michalek. What a generous and friendly guy. This interview was so much fun, and I'm really glad that I got to meet Jerry and do it in person. Again, you can find links to everything we discussed in this episode by cruising over the website and checking out the show notes at 3gunshow.com/episode29. All right, now I want to tell you about an awesome giveaway that we're doing this week in partnership with the good folks at LAG Tactical. But first, I have to tell you about how this came about. One of the many interactive people following the 3-Gun Show on Instagram is 3-Gun Lou. He reached out to me and asked if I'd want to do a giveaway with one of his sponsors and connected me with Hunter over at LAG. I spent some time on the phone chatting with Hunter, and because I enjoy associating with good people and good product, I knew we had to do this. It's one of the many reasons I love the listeners of the show and 3-Gunners in general. They're just generally good people, and they want to support each other, and I really love being a part of that. So be sure to check out Lou on Instagram. Just search for 3-Gun Lou. Now, I'm excited about this giveaway because I've been digging LAG's holsters ever since chatting with James Casanova in episode 6. Side note, if you haven't heard that one or you want to listen again, just head over to 3gunshow.com/episode6. Anyway, LAG's new competition line was designed and tested in collaboration with James, and the holster was thus named the Supernova, as a nod to Mr. Casanova, which is really cool. So this is the same gear that you see. This is also the same gear that you see in Jenna Reeves Brownell's 3-Gun videos. If you haven't seen those yet, I've gotten a link in the show notes as well. So Hunter from LAG is putting up a $205 gift certificate, which will be enough to get you a Supernova holster, a competition pistol magazine carrier, a competition rifle magazine carrier with attachments of your choice. And I recommend you go with that gear, but if you already are squared away in that area, or, you know, you need to shore up some other area, you can use the gift certificate anywhere in the store, which is really cool. All you have to do to enter is head over to 3gunshow.com/LAG and fill out the form there. Sound good? All right, this is going to be fun. Anytime you have any thoughts or feedback or guest suggestions, you can email me. I'm Dave at 3gunshow.com. If you like the show, please tell a friend, subscribe in iTunes, and leave a review. And reviews are huge for the rankings of the show. It helps listeners and 3-Gunners like you and me find the show. Thank you so much for downloading, listening, and subscribing. I'll catch you in the next episode.
Unload, show clear.